You can put it on the ball.
Oh, yeah.
You have to have the opposite effect. Right. Just to make sure it gets on your face.
We're trying to build up your hands.
You put some foot on there.
Well, right.
Really? Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Yep. Yeah. No, I live not even a mile away.
Awesome.
My sister and my brother-in-law are all in such a good love.
Oh, okay.
They're all teachers. And he's a
awesome.
Yeah,
so. Really, really nice to meet
yeah,
you guys.
Nice to meet you.
Good morning. How are you?
Good.
Good to see you. Hello, everyone.
Good morning.
Need to get this on, I think, right? Unless, test, hello, we're good. Awesome, great to see you all today. Glad to be here at the ward. Eager to have an opportunity to spend some time in God's word with you. I'm Pastor Brian Hockman, one of the pastors on staff here, and it's my turn in the rotation to lead you. We're continuing our series called Knowing God, and today we're gonna take a look at a lesson from the book of Matthew, Matthew chapter 21. But I'd like to start us out with just a thought question. So feel free to share some thoughts with people at the table with you, or just spend some time to think about how you might answer this question, and then we'd be glad to bring it back together and share some thoughts. What does it mean and what does it look like to set your heart on something? I'm going to give you a few seconds to think about that. All right, what did you get? Who'd like to start us out? Who'd like to share some thoughts? What does it mean? What does it look like to set your heart on something?
I just said to make it a high priority in your life.
Okay, if your heart is set on something, that means it's something that's going to be a priority to you. Okay, anyone else? Abby. Okay, it's going to have your attention and your focus.
It looks like all of your kind of actions have that goal or direction. So.
Okay, you're going to have passions. Yeah, I like the goal, because to accomplish a goal, you have to make some commitments, right? Whether that's time or money or I want to achieve that goal. This thing is, I'm passionate about this, and so I'm going to... It's going to become an important part of my life.
Just in my mind, too, is something that, like, no outside force can sway you from. It's something that you're then set on doing, no matter what anybody else says.
Okay, nothing can sway me from this. I'm going to set my eyes on that goal at, like a prize, right? And nothing is going to distract me because it's important, right? There are some things that are lower on the priority list that maybe you can get done, but it's sort of if I have time or if I feel like it. But to have something that my heart is set on, it means that I've got this tunnel vision and that's what I'm going towards. And nothing is going to distract me from that. All right. Today we're going to find out about our God, and we're going to learn that our God wants our hearts. Our God wants us to have hearts that are set on Him. And so we're going to take a look at this lesson from Matthew chapter 21. We're going to divide it into two chunks because it really is, Jesus has this interaction with the chief priests and teachers of the law, and then tells a parable. So we'll look at the interaction first and why it goes the way that it does. So Matthew 21, verse 23 through 27. Jesus entered the temple courts, and while he was teaching, the chief priests and elders of the people came to him. "By what authority are you doing these things?" they asked. "And who gave you this authority?" Jesus replied, "I will also ask you one question. If you answer me, I will tell you by what authority I am doing these things. John's baptism, where did it come from? Was it from heaven or from human or of human origin?" They discussed it among themselves and said, "If we say from heaven, he will ask, then why didn't you believe him? But if we say of human origin, we are afraid of the people, for they hold that John was a prophet." So they answered Jesus, "We don't know." Then he said, "Neither will I tell you by what authority I am doing these things." So, just set the context for you just a little bit. Jesus speaks these words just before, it's during Holy Week. And Jesus speaks these words, I should say, just after his cleansing of the temple. So that was the day before. Jesus comes in and he identifies that the money changers had turned it into the den of robbers, is what he calls it. That they had been taking advantage of the people who were the pilgrims that were coming in and needing to make their sacrifices for the festival. They were overcharging, and they basically had turned church into a marketplace instead of a place of worship. And so Jesus overturns their tables and chases the moneylenders out and releases the birds that were going to be sold for those sacrifices, and tries to set God's house back to what he intended it to be. He says, "My Father's house is a house of prayer." So Jesus does these things and then comes back to the temple. And now the chief priests, the teachers of the law, the ones that thought that they were the ones in charge, that they were the ones who had the authority, they come and they question Jesus. "By whose authority are you doing these things?" That's what he's talking about. Trying to be like you're in charge of the temple, or by whose authority are you teaching the things that you're teaching without clearing them with us first? So that's sort of the setting and background here. So then I'm going to give you a second to think about the question I've got there. It seems strange that Jesus wouldn't proudly announce the source of his authority. We know what the answer is. It's God who gave him the authority. It's the authority that he had in and of himself as the Son of God. Normally, Jesus was pretty vocal about that, very willing to confess by whose authority he was doing those things, but not this time. And I want you to think about that for a little bit. What is Jesus trying to accomplish here? Take a few minutes and discuss, gather your thoughts.
Thank you.
What do you think? What was Jesus trying to accomplish by asking a question instead of answering a question? What was he trying to do? Please.
Maybe trying to stay closer to you, because he had divine power, he could have done anything, but he chose to have control of that so that he set an example for the people to follow.
Okay, sure. He had that divine power. He could have performed some awesome miracle. You want to know whose authority? Lightning, right? Or he turned his bottle of water into blood. He could have done any of those things to sarcastically or dramatically prove that he definitely belonged and definitely had the authority to do what he was doing. Anyone else? Please. Okay, he does leave them kind of tail between their legs. They have to sort of walk away from this, right? They were full. They would have fully expected and understood that he was going to claim divine authority, and they must have been ready with his answer, but they weren't ready for the way that Jesus did answer. So we see that often. Jesus reads the minds of the people. And responds according to their thoughts instead of what they've actually said. Or my favorite is when Jesus answers the question that they should have been asking instead of the question that they actually did ask. So there are definitely times that Jesus does that and employs his divine power or wisdom or understanding or omniscience, the fact that he's all-knowing in the way that he interacts with people. Here he chooses to kind of set that aside and let it kind of draws it out a little bit more, right? Which ends up being a somewhat dramatic way to respond. And it also puts them on the spot to answer and to have to think through, why is it that they've done the things the way they've done them? Why is it that they have chosen not to accept divine authority, right? So he points out John, who they didn't believe in, and they didn't respect as a prophet of God, even though the people did. So he puts them in this spot where they've got to choose between actually exposing what they really believed and doing it in a way that's going to rile up the people, or appeasing the people and lying through their teeth. He puts them in this no-win situation, and they're forced to weasel out and say, I don't know. I guess I don't know the answer. They knew that they were trapped in a way that wouldn't have happened if Jesus had just flat out answered their question, right? If Jesus had just said, no, from God, my authority is from God, and by the way, I'm the Son of God. He could have answered that question, and it would have been absolutely true. And I'm sure there would be a temptation to answer in a way that was serving of himself, right? In a way that presented him presented him to be the one he was and to have the power that he did. But instead, it's in an effort to show love to the people. It's in an effort to teach. Jesus is the master teacher, and he never passes an opportunity to teach. And he sees here, even in the face of defiance against his authority, sinful defiance against his authority, he still has enough love for those people who were questioning him that he deals patiently with them. He forces them to engage rather than just defiance and disbelief and putting Jesus at arm's length. He forces them to engage, makes their brains start to think, and does it in a way that makes an attempt to teach them. Any other comments or questions on that first segment of the lesson? Second one is sort of the continuation, you can see the connection because Jesus talks about John at the last half of this next of the parable that he teaches. So this is Matthew 21:28 through 35.
What do you think? Jesus goes on. There was a man who had two sons. He went to the first and said, Son, go and work today in the vineyard. I will not, he answered, but later changed his mind and went. Then the father went to the other son and said the same thing. He answered, I will, sir, but he did not go. Which of the two did what his father wanted? The first, they answered. Jesus said to them, Truly I tell you, the tax collectors and prostitutes are entering the kingdom of God ahead of you. For John came to show you the way of righteousness, and you did not believe him. But the tax collectors and prostitutes did. And even after you saw this, you did not repent and believe him. Oops, I missed. Sorry about that. So, Zach, is my audio still on? I am. Good. Thank you. So, Jesus tells this parable about these two sons. And so let me ask you the question. I guess we'll flip backwards. Which of the sons was the better son? The one that said no to the request and then changed his mind later and does it? Or the one that says, yeah, I'll do it, and then never actually gets around to doing the work? The son that says no and then changes his mind. Yeah, the no yes son, right? I think we probably would, if I had to ask you which son would you like to have as your son, you might answer the third one. The third one who says yes and does yes. Because neither one is very fun, right? But if you had to choose between these two options, you would probably choose the one that actually did the work, right? Even if they were sassy, sarcastic, stubborn, defiant at the start, at least they came around and understood how important it was. So, which of the sons was Jesus identifying as these chief priests and teachers to be? This parable is a little difficult. If you don't catch it right away, that's all right. But Jesus is using this picture because he's telling these chief priests, these teachers of the law, that they're one of those sons.
They're the second son.
Tell me, you're correct. Tell me why they're the second son.
Well, because they say yes, they'll do all those things for Jesus, and they make a big spectacle of themselves, showing that they're doing it, but they're really doing it for themselves, and they don't believe.
Okay, very well said. They make a show of being the ones that say yes. Yes to God. We're the chief priests. We're the religious leaders. We're the ones that are living the outwardly religious, openly religious life. But when it comes to Jesus is saying, when it comes to actually doing the things that God asks you to do, they are the ones that never actually get to doing it. Yeah, very good. They're the second son. So with that thought in mind, I'd like you to explain the answer. That's this next one. Explain Jesus' response to the way the Pharisees answered his question. And before we turn on the music, I just want to make sure we're all on the right verse there. So they answer the first. And Jesus said, Truly I tell you, the tax collectors and prostitutes are entering the kingdom of God ahead of you. For John came to you to show you the way of righteousness, and you did not believe him. But the tax collectors and prostitutes did. And even after you saw this, you did not repent and believe him. So you can sense a little bit of frustration or maybe even anger in Jesus' answer. And I want you to think about that. And then we'll bring it back and review. All right. Explain Jesus' response. Explain his anger, his frustration. Did I call them Pharisees, that really teachers, chief priests and teachers. Did they get the question wrong? No, they gave the right answer, right? So explain Jesus' response, almost an angry response. What's going on there? Okay.
Jesus was angry that they were, you know, just kind of ignoring the fact that he was talking about that.
Yeah. Jesus wasn't upset that they got the question wrong. He was upset that they didn't understand why the question was asked. They didn't understand or weren't, well, I like the way you said it. Either they didn't understand or they weren't willing to accept the fact that Jesus was talking about them. They were the ones who said yes, but then did nothing. They were the ones that might start out to be the desired child, right? Every parent loves a child who's going to say yes when they're asked to do something. But they weren't the children that God wanted because they didn't have any deeds. They didn't have any action to follow it up. They were the son that said yes and then ended up doing nothing. So, in what way were the prostitutes and tax collectors like the first son in Jesus' story? Okay. So they were like the ones who said no, right? Whether that was an outward rejection of God from the start or whether it was just ignorance that caused their unbelief, they didn't respond to God's call. They didn't respond to by starting their lives in faith and belief. They were the sons that said no, but eventually changed their minds. Eventually, for whatever reason, they changed their minds and started to do the things that God wanted them to do, right? Now, we know what the reason was. We know the connection between the story of the son and the actual lives of the tax collectors and prostitutes. It was God-worked repentance. That word repentance is a word that means to change, to turn. And so that gives light and shines the light a little bit on what Jesus says at the very end in verse 32. He says, and even after you saw this, even after you saw the tax collectors and prostitutes entering the kingdom of God, you did not repent and believe in him. Even when you saw that sinners were gaining access to God and his kingdom and to his promises, you still wanted nothing to do with this. You still were insistent on the fact that you were the good sons because you said yes and you looked good on the outside. What makes a person good, what makes a Christian good, is a repentant heart. A heart that is willing to be turned over to Jesus, not one that stands on the rooftops and lauds their own power, lauds their own standing in the church. And so Jesus here was teaching repentance and was mourning the fact that these religious leaders didn't understand. They thought they knew what being a God-fearing believer was all about, but they didn't get it at all. And so Jesus is here to teach them repentance. All right, we're going to talk about repentance in a little bit, but for now, let's join and sing this song.
We have come.
God sends his prophet Ezekiel in the Old Testament to work and to announce his request and his demand that his people repent of their sins. Ezekiel is the prophet that goes into captivity in Babylon. And so he's serving God's people who are already experiencing the consequences for their sins, for their rejection, for the fact that they turned their backs on God. Yet Ezekiel is living proof that God never turned his back on them. He continues to send the prophet Ezekiel to them. And here in chapter 18, verses 30 through 32, we see some of Ezekiel serving that prophet role and calling God's people to repentance. Therefore, you Israelites, I will judge each of you according to your own ways, declares the sovereign Lord. Repent. Turn away from all your offenses, then sin will not be your downfall. Rid yourselves of all the offenses you have committed and get a new heart and a new spirit. Why will you die, people of Israel? For I take no pleasure in the death of anyone, declares the sovereign Lord. Repent. And live. All right, so with those thoughts in mind, I'd like you to define the word repentance. Take a minute, jot some notes, define repentance. It's going to make the music go away. It's okay, I can sing. It's Ezekiel 18, verse 30 to 32, if you'd like to look that up. I'll put it back up when we do the discussion part. How about that? All right, we'll go back to the Ezekiel passage. Who'd like to start us out? with a definition of repentance.
To change.
Okay, repentance is a change, for sure. Please.
Acknowledgement of transgression, but subsequent request for forgiveness.
Okay, very good. An acknowledgement of transgression, so I admit that I'm sinful, and then say the second part again. With a request for forgiveness. So there's an acknowledgement of not just my sinfulness, but also my standing with God, right? Knowing that God is high above me, that God is the one who can and will forgive me my sins, right? Repenting to someone who can't extend forgiveness. Although, when we sin against one another, we do confess our sins to each other. But godly repentance is recognizing where I stand in this relationship. So, great answer. Thank you.
I'll take it like a step further and say it's that acknowledgement and asking for forgiveness for your sins, but then following through with the actions to become closer to God, so that you're more like the third son.
Okay. Okay. That now I'm going to live my life. This change isn't just, okay, well, I can undo that one thing, and then now I'm going to go back and just continue to live however I want, continue to commit the same old sins. And, you know, it's not this get out of jail free. I just have to flip the coins that I messed up on, and now I can go on. That there is a part of repentance that is a lifestyle change. Yeah, well said. Okay, anyone else want to contribute?
I think the first thing is you're on a path, recognizing you're on a path, the wrong path, and turn, where it says to turn. So you would turn and go over to the correct path and get you on the right path. So in a way, it's getting rid of that. And part of that, it says rid yourself of all offenses. So getting rid of that wrong path, turning and getting in the correct path.
Okay. Okay, yeah, whether if it's two paths or maybe it's I'm just going the wrong way down the same path and the turning is, now I'm going to walk the right way, right? I teach my catechism kids that there's one path and it's God on the one side and Satan on the other, and with my sins, my back is to God and I'm walking down a path of evil, right? But then repentance is that turning to be able to now go back and walk towards God and with God. So, but you could use the picture that you had too. There's the fork in the road. There's the I'm on the wrong side, and the changing is to get onto the right path. Okay. Anyone else? Anything to add? These are all good thoughts. Okay, very good. It's very important to recognize God has to be involved in this, right? I don't decide, oh man, this life of sinfulness, this life of walking towards the devil, it's just not doing it for me, so I'm going to make a change, right? You might change career paths, you might change sports teams, you might change whatever, but changing a sinful life to become a godly life is not something we have the power to do. So, in that, I didn't give you the full picture of what I'm teaching the catechism kids, is walking in the wrong way with my back towards God, but it's God himself, it's the Holy Spirit that takes me by the shoulder and enables me to walk back towards him. And now it's a togetherness project, right? Now I can live my life of sanctification, and part of sanctification is saying no to things that I know are displeasing to the Lord. Looking at the law and to please God, choosing the right things, or confessing my failures with God's help and seeking his strength to live that life that you were talking about, right? To live the life of striving to do better next time, of striving to avoid those sins in the future. And that's kind of where we're going with the next passage. Acts 5, verse 30 through 32. Let me set the context for you on this section of scripture just real quickly. So this is Peter and John. Pentecost is Acts chapter 2. Peter and John are going around and preaching the gospel in Jerusalem, and then they get arrested, and they get put on trial, and they're told, you're not allowed to preach this Jesus guy anymore. These same chief priests, teachers that Jesus interacted with in the gospel lesson are now trying to squash the disciples and their message. And Peter has the famous passage just verses before this. He says, we must obey God rather than men. He says, no, we're not going to stop preaching. We can't. We can't stop preaching the things that God has done for us. So that's, he continues that same thought here in verse 30. Peter and the other apostles replied, we must obey God rather than human beings. The God of our ancestors raised Jesus from the dead, whom you killed by hanging him on a cross. God exalted him to his own right hand as prince and savior, that he might bring Israel to repentance and forgive their sins. We are witnesses of these things, and so is the Holy Spirit, whom God has given to those who obey him. I had planned to break this one out into group two, but I think we kind of started down the discussion in a good way in the last time, so we won't do the music for this one. But how is God's definition of repentance one that can and does bring us great joy? The fact that he's involved in the process, right? The fact that we can't repent without him. We can't change from our sinful behaviors. We can't turn our lives around unless God is involved. So in this passage where it's talking about how God is the one who worked repentance for Israel, we're seeing how this is that turning, that's the conversion idea of repentance, that there's this turning back on sin and now being able to walk towards God. And now when that's happened to us, that's solely the work of God. But now that we as Christians who have faith in our hearts and have the Holy Spirit working in us and helping us to do the things that God wants us to do, now we can repent of our sins as a fruit of faith, mindful of the fact that God is the God who can work us, who can work repentance for us, understanding that it is still God working in my heart that I cooperate in something like a sanctified life, that I cooperate in something like confessing my sins, repenting of them, the strides that I make in keeping sin at arm's length are those that are only motivated by God dwelling within me. But when it comes to conversion, when it comes to I'm an unbeliever and how do I become a believer, that kind of repentance, that kind of turning is solely the work of God. But now, as we, fellow Christians, with faith in our hearts, with the ability to do things that are pleasing to God, now we have the ability also to repent and to confess our sins daily and to receive the forgiveness and to receive the power for life change that God gives to us. Now we work with him in that sanctified life. So there was another passage that I was going to bring up, Acts 11. We're running out of time here, so we won't look that one up. But Acts 11, verse 15 through 18, maybe jot that down and read that story after lunch for devotion. You'll find another passage similar to the one from Acts chapter 5. In that passage, Peter talks about how God has granted repentance even to the Gentiles. And I wanted to bring that passage up because it reinforces that truth that God is the one who's behind it all. God's the one who works that repentance. You could read a passage like Ezekiel, and if you don't have that in your mind that God's the one who does this, you could read that and that could be a real downer. Just turn your back on sin is all you got to do, and then you can live. Yeah, that's great if it were that simple, but I can't. But there's joy and there's hope and there's freedom in the understanding that God's working with me, that God has done the heavy lifting, that he's the one who has taken my sins to the cross and built me up in his blood and washed me clean through the waters of baptism. And now, with him dwelling in my heart, I can lead a life of repentance. I can lead a life that acknowledges my total inability and insufficiency to receive God's grace, but the fact that God has changed me, turned me, and works with me daily towards repentance and godly living. This brings joy, hope, peace, and everlasting life into our hearts and lives. All right. Oops, there's our discussion music. I thought this was a cool picture, and so I thought I'd put it up here. This is another passage from later on in Ezekiel. And I will remove the heart of stone and give you a heart of flesh. He's talking about the heart transplant that he gives to his people. God gives people new hearts. He turns unbelief into belief. He turns unbelievers into temples of the Holy Spirit. And that's what he has done for us, changing us, turning us, and making us his own. All right. Let's conclude with a prayer. Lord God, Heavenly Father, we thank you for this opportunity to be together in your house today. We thank you for the privilege of knowing your love for us, shown to us in the person of Jesus. Lord, we thank you that you sent Jesus to take our sins away, that he bore their guilt on the cross, and that he suffered our punishment and pain in our place. We thank you for his amazing grace, that undeserved love, that though we don't have anything, any merit in and of ourselves, that you are willing to claim us to be forever children of the Heavenly Father. Lord, we ask that you forgive us for the times that we fail to see our stubbornness and our unbelief, for the times that we don't repent like we should, yet we rejoice that you have worked repentance in our hearts, that you have changed our lives forever, that you have turned us to the right path, and that now we can see you and serve you with our lives. Lord, give us your wisdom every day to know what pleases you and to make decisions that are in line with your will. Lord, help us to see the repentance that is needed in our lives, and give us the strength to do just that, to turn away from sin and to embrace godly living that you enable us to do. Lord, you want our hearts, and we rejoice that you have given us the new hearts that are the ones that you desire. We celebrate the fact that you are ours and we are yours because of what Jesus has done for us. Lord, build us up in that truth. Fill our hearts and our lives with joy today and every day. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We'll sing our closing song.
So if your sky is dark,
grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen. Thank you all for coming. So glad to have had this hour of worship with you. Please take your service folders home if you'd like. The grace notes are in there, so you can get a little snapshot as far as what's happening in our church here in Milwaukee. Great to see you all, and have a wonderful week.